Hey everybody, Clay Archer, CEO DPC Technology, and today I'm going to do a quick review of the new Atomos XCast desktop application. About a year ago, Gerald Undone did a really good review of the Atomos XCast and how you compare it with a Ninja 5 and do a really nice desktop switcher. So I ran out and bought an XCast, and I've actually been really enjoying my XCast for the last year. Without rambling on too much, I'm gonna jump down into the software and I'm gonna show you what XCast desktop really looks like. So for anybody that's familiar with the XCast, the desktop app looks very similar to the app itself. The buttons look very similar. For me, the biggest thing about the XCast is getting files on it, getting files off of it, doing the settings. And besides the fact that it's just a good switcher, and right now I've got this main shot, I've got my laptop as a HDMI input, and I've got the overhead shot, and I've got a wide shot. So right now I've got four shots set up, and we're gonna go in. I'm actually pushing the buttons on the switcher itself to go back and forth between each one. But now I'm gonna jump into the software, and you can see by doing the same thing, pushing those buttons, it does similar things. But instead of having to have kind of these function buttons and going into menus, now I have all of these other items that I can do inside of this one shot. So if I click on picture in picture, it will bring that shot of my laptop into picture in picture. Same thing with the overhead shot, same thing with the wide shot. Pretty cool. I can change that location, I can change that size, you know, pretty easy stuff. But it's so much easier for me to manipulate that inside of with my mouse than it is to do it with the switcher itself. Also, all of these things that you can do are also, if you go into the menus up above, have keyboard shortcuts. So you can see the 1, 2, 3, 4 there. So on your keyboard, you can go 1, 2, 3, 4. You also get the option to do these overlays. And I can tell you that everybody that I ever do a Teams call or a web call of any sort goes, how did you get that fancy overlay? Of course, I could probably do it with OBS or something along those lines, but it's pretty cool to be able just to click a button and have that just be up there. So I could, just by pushing G, I can hide it, I can put it back on. The nice thing about it though is to get that up there, all I go is to the overlays button and I can choose the files. There's a couple things to it. In this graphics tab, I go over here and I can choose them off of my computer. This is connected by USB to my computer, and I can go through anything and grab an image, bring it over. The images have to be under a megabyte, must be PNGs, and they have to be 1920 by 1080, but you can put those up there. And you can see I have a bunch of iterations here of things that these were actually just tests, like these were, this was too big. So I did another one, I did another one. Now you only get to have 8 up there, so I'll remove that. And this is, you know, kind of me being a little sloppy by not removing them, but you can put them in here, up to 8 of them. And then you can have a preset for each input. So if I wanted to put on this one, I wanted to use a preset 2 or preset 1, I could have that there, and let's say on the last one, I wanted to have that preset 2. That's cool. Or if I wanted to go to preset 3 and make a preset 3 and just have this be in green, I could do that as well, and then I could use preset 3. And if I go back over into the switcher, you can see if I push G again to bring up my overlays, I can have that overlay on each one of these. So I'm just pushing G, going to that, pushing G, going to that, pushing G. Also, I can click record up here. I can go live or unlive. So you will see when you first fire up the XCast, it does not cast. It will not show up in your Teams or your Zoom meeting. You have to click on the live button to make the video go live. Record records it internally. It is 1080p when it's recording, obviously. This isn't a 4K switcher, but it does a really nice job, and that's recording internally to the SSD on the Ninja 5. One other really cool thing is that Atomos has put out 4 or 5 videos on how to set it up that are really good. Future Clay here, I forgot to mention that I will do a full blog post. That link will be in the description. So if you're looking for links to anything or you want a little bit more detail, check out that blog post. It will be in the link down below. Back to the video. But you know, just quickly as an overview, you can change your dip color. So if you're gonna fade with a dip instead of the cuts, I was doing cuts before, but if you dip, it'll go to white and then go in there, and if you hit here. And I'm assuming over time, they will probably add some more transition features. One other feature you can see here, it's probably driving you as crazy as it's driving me, is that my overhead is upside down. I can't flip just this one input, and maybe this is just me being a little obtuse, but I can flip it in the XCast itself, but then it flips all my inputs. So one thing I would like to see is like an orientation where I can flip horizontally and vertically my inputs, but I can't at this point in time, and I've looked through it. If you know of it or you know how to do it, please put a comment down in the comments, because I would love to be able to make that happen seamlessly for me. Other things in here, you go to inputs, it's just showing your inputs. You could rename these inputs. So this is an A7S3. Then you can see what it's using there as far as a LUT. I'm gonna go to output here. I'm not doing a monitor out now, but if I did want to put a monitor in front of me that was showing, you can show me a program, it can show me my preview, which is the next thing I have on the queue, or it could give me multi-view of all four of them. So if you wanted to run HDMI out to another monitor, you can do that. Right now, I just have it showing on the Ninja itself, so you can just see that's where I'm monitoring what my shot looks like. Also, you can change your codecs and compression levels, that kind of stuff if you're recording. I showed you a little bit of the overlays. You can move it around if you wanted the overlay to be in a different spot. It's pretty simple to do these graphics. I did have to adjust the size of the pings just to get them so that they fit it right on the screen, but you would have to do that no matter what anyways. And lastly, and this is really a neat feature, is obviously the LUTs. So I'm using a bunch of Sony cameras here, and I use Caleb Pike's LUTs. I'm in S-Log 3. If you haven't checked out DSLR video shooter Caleb Pike's LUT packs, I really recommend them. They do a really nice job. But you can quickly and easily load a LUT here into each one of the cameras, which is pretty awesome. You can also color match cameras. So I don't really do this. I'm not to this level of OCD, but if I was, the two that probably would be best to color match are these two Sonys. What you would do here is you would put a color guide in each shot, and the AI would see the color guide and it would match the colors to each other. So I have not done that. That being said, you have the ability to do it. You can also, if I want to preview them all, I can see what they all are going to look like together. And that pretty much is how I am using the XCast. There are more features in here. There's the mic levels, and I can have audio follow each different mic. For me, I have the Sony attachment and an XLR boom mic above me. So I just run my audio through my A7S3, which is pretty simple for my setup. But if you had a more complicated setup or you had multiple mics, you certainly can do that. You could have the audio follow the video if you wanted to as well. You can just do a quick fade out, change the duration of it. I think the real takeaway here though is that it's just easier to use it in the desktop app. It's easier to get your stuff configured and looking right. And for me, it really has taken this XCast to the next level, and my user experience has definitely improved. One last thing, you know, there are some little idiosyncrasies of the app that if you don't know, you don't know. When I first got XCast, I couldn't figure out why it wasn't giving output to Teams, and it was just simple button right here, release to other apps. It takes the feed away from the XCast desktop app and gives it to you. Teams or Zoom or whatever you're trying to stream to. So that's that quick little button there. I'll put a link down in the description, but you can see on that input too, I have the XCast up on Amazon right now. It's $149. It's usually $199, but for $149, if you already have a Ninja, I think this is a no-brainer. There's also a link to a bundle. I think the bundle is like $499 for a Ninja and the XCast. I will tell you that they are coming out now with the newer Ninjas, and I probably would look at getting the newer one. I don't know that they're gonna update the Ninja 5 into the version 11 of the software. So if you already have a Ninja, I think this is a great opportunity to have a switcher for only $149. If you are looking at getting a whole system, I would get the newer Ninja with the XCast. That way going forward, you'll have a longer development path. If you have any questions, please put them in the comments down below. I answer all of those for you. So if you want to know about an output or an input or something I didn't cover here, feel free to ask me. I will respond to you. If you like these kind of videos, please like and subscribe. Otherwise, we'll see you guys in the next video.